Okay, so today I'm going to talk about my work on saline tolerant high yielding rice, and this is using three mechanisms. I have like DNA marker assisted breeding, genetic modification, or gene editing. So I've actually summarized what I want to say in this starting slide, and here we started characterizing this rice landrace Horkuch, which is very popular in the southwest coast of Bangladesh. We started characterizing it, then we made a mapping population, mapped it, and then to marker assisted breeding. This took about 10 years starting from the characterization, and these lines are under testing now. And then there's my work on transgenic rice using, we transformed regulatory genes. And I have 11 salt and drought tolerant stable commercial lines, which are in the T5 generation. But unfortunately, all of these products are still in the lab after 15 years. And then I have, for the last 5 years, we've been working on CRISPR-Cas9 knockout technology, but this was mainly to use the CRISPR-Cas9 for proof of concept of the mechanism of Horkuch. However, using this technique, we've also produced some salt tolerant lines. So I'm going to talk about this in the, so to recap the salinity scenario in Bangladesh. So if you can see.
Professor Jewa.
Ji.
No, I'm sorry, actually, because of this, some mechanical trouble, I could not start from the beginning. But I'm now following. The slide you just passed is the first slide, right?
Yes, this is the second slide. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Okay. So currently, rice does not grow below the blue line. This is in the southwest in the dry season. But by 2050, rice will not be able to grow under the red line here. And this translates to a decrease of 26% in an increase of 26% in the salinity levels in the coastal areas, and which translates into a 15.6% decrease in the 9 coastal upazilas in rice by 2050. And at the same time, the population of Bangladesh will rise from 160 to 240 million by 2050. So we really need to increase rice production, particularly in these, you know, saline areas. So to recap, what marker-assisted backcrossing means is, as you know, for any donor desirable trait, usually it's controlled by multiple genes. So we call it a quantitative locus, so it's or a QTL region. So the first step involves selecting that QTL region in your progeny, and this is called foreground selection. And then the second step is the recombinant selection, because in the chromosome that the QTL resides on both sides, you want the commercial background. So you select for the commercial background on both exactly adjacent to the QTL region. So that's called recombinant selection. And for the rest of the chromosomes, you want the recipient or the high yielding background. So you select for the high yielding background in the rest of the chromosomes. So below you can actually see for conventional backcrossing, it might take up to 10 generations to do this work, whereas in marker-assisted backcrossing, you can do that in 2 generations. And if you have multiple QTLs, then you have to repeat this for the QTL selection for the second or the third QTL, as you may have. So starting with this landrace Horkuch, this naturally grows in the saline-affected coastal regions of Bangladesh. And it has evolved over many years and adapted to the saline coastal conditions. And this is also called a traditional variety. So the main feature of this rice, and the farmers in the southwest Khulna region and Shatke region, they like this rice because it shows a low loss in fertility and yield under salt stress. So according to the farmers, it was a good rice, and also, we also characterized it. So we generated a mapping population, a reciprocal mapping population using Horkuch as one parent, and IR-29, a sensitive commercial rice, as another parent. So this was a reciprocal cross. Once Horkuch was the mother, and in the second line, the IR-29 was the mother. So we generated this reciprocal population and did the mapping. So, of course, for the mapping, you have to do the phenotyping as well. And here, Biri was a partner in this work. And Dr. Sajjadur Rahman, he actually produced the reciprocal population at Erie. And the phenotyping was done at Biri. So the phenotyping was done by Sajjadur Rahman, Shudeep Bishya. She's at UT, Texas A&M, doing his PhD now. And Sumaiya Farah Khan, who is an associate professor in Jagannath University. So we did the screening at both the seedling and the reproductive stages. But here, I've just shown the reproductive stage. It is more complex. And it was 4-replicate soil-based system and under 80 millimolar stress. So then, of course, we produced the map. This is a pre-publication, but we have submitted this to the Rice Journal now. And we found a number of QTLs for salt tolerance. So how do we decide which is the most important? So we also did the transcriptomics of this population that we had among the tolerant and the sensitive progeny. And from that, we decided. So this work was done by Taslima Haq and Dr. Sabrina Elias, who is now at IUB, an assistant professor. So we chose 3 QTLs from Horkuch, and then we moved into this DNA marker-assisted backcrossing. This was a World Bank assisted project, funded project, and Biri was our partner here. So the idea was to introduce 3 salt-tolerant QTLs into the genomic background of Biridhan 63, Biridhan 67, and Biridhan 74. So this map actually shows the ideal genotype, where you would have the 3 QTLs from chromosome 1, 2, and 3, and the rest of the markers that shows the background. So these are the markers we actually used to select for the background of 63, 67, and 74. So what we actually had to do is QTL pyramiding, because it was like 3 QTLs. So among the mapping population, we had 2 very tolerant recombinant InMed lines. One is called I-14, which had 2 of the QTLs in chromosome 2, the root length QTL, and the potassium QTL in chromosome 3. And the recombinant InMed I-71 had another QTL called the Saltol QTL. So this was recombined into the background of Biridhan 63, 67, and 74. So in order to speed this process, we used fluorescent markers, to select the progenies. And of course, we used SNP-based marker technology. And the method we use, it's called CASP technology, which stands for Competitive Allele-Specific PCR. And its advantage is that it's cheaper than TACPAN. For TACPAN, you have to use, for every SNP, you have to design fluorescent markers, which makes it very expensive. But in this case, the allele-specific primers are not fluorescent. The fluorescent fluorophore is attached to the second step. So that makes the method a bit cheaper. And this is how CASP works. So usually we have bialleles, 2 alleles at either, which gives the tolerance or the sensitivity or the background, whatever. So here you can see that for the 4, for the 2 forward primers, for the 2 alleles, this forward primer has a tail X and the alternative allele has a tail Y. And in the second step, the fluorophore FAM will only bind to the tail X and the fluorophore hex will bind only to the tail Y, so that the fluorophores become allele specific. So that's the technology. Anyway, so then we went about crossing. So I-14 was crossed with each of BD63, 67, and 74, and I-71 also crossed likewise with each of them. And then the F1 from each cross was produced, and the 2 F1s were double crossed. Okay, they were crossed with each other. And then this double cross was again back crossed to these 3 commercial varieties again to produce the back cross 1 F1. And of course, from then on, another back cross, and now we have the back cross 2 F3, which we are characterizing now. And this crossing work was done by Dr. Ruhul Amin of Biri and Dr. Sajjadur Rahman. And of course, the selection The CAST mark was the marker done was done at Dhaka University, and this was actually done by two MSc students, Tomalika Azim and Yamin Farabi. So how this, you can see that because the fluorophores are allele specific, you can actually, after you run your DNA from the progeny through PCR and do a quantitative detection, you can actually see which of the plants have allele 2 because there's a specific fluorophore attached to it, and which of the progenies have allele 1 because of the other alternate fluorophore. And of course, the heterozygous plants have some a color in between. So you can, just by running PCR in 2 to 3 hours, you can select which allele is present in your progeny. So this next slide actually shows how the selection was done for the three QTLs. So we have the Saltol QTL, and then for the root length QTL, and for the potassium QTL. So you can see that allele 1 here is marked by an oval marker, allele 2 is triangular, and the heterozygote is square. So we select for, so allele 1 is the donor-like allele. So we select these plants which had the allele 1, and also we selected plants which had the heterozygous allele, because when you backcross, you can get the desired allele. So this is the selection for the plants for the Saltol, for the root length, as well as for the potassium QTL. So then one of these plants, which has the ID 342, we could see that it had all the three. So this is the backcross 1, F1, and we could see that this plant had all the three QTLs in the allele 1, the donor allele. These are, you can see the red marks there. So they had the QTL, and then the recipient allele was blue, and the heterozygous was yellow. So most of this region, the desired region, had either yellow or red. So this was a desired, and this one had a background recovery percentage of 78.6%. So these are three of the best six lines that we had. Again, this slide shows that, so these are the six lines. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lines. And you can see that, you can see the red or the yellow there. And that's the QTLs that have been shown for the three QTLs. So in the next slide, we see that, so we had these best six lines. So in four of them, we had three QTLs and a recovery from 60 to about 80% recovery of the background genome. And two of the lines had two QTLs and one QTL. So this work actually was completed in May this year, and Biri and Dhaka University produced a leaflet with showing the success of this approach. And now we are characterizing the backcross to F3 progenies. So this is a survival screenings test, and you can see some of the lines look very, very promising. So after doing this round of screening, we are going to do further screening and characterize these for further stress tolerance parameters. So this actually completes my first part of the marker-assisted work. And as I said, the publication with Horkoch, this came out in 2011, and this is actually 2021. So it's about 10 years now. So changing gears now, so my work on transgenic rice. So over the years, we have produced many lines, as I said, 11 stable lines, and the work was all published in international journals, peer-reviewed journals, and with high impact factor. So to summarize what we have now, we have lines in which we have transformed rice lines. This is actually the first one, Hardy. This is in the background of BR27. So this increases water use efficiency. You may know that to produce 1 kilogram of rice, it needs 2,500 liters of water, fresh water actually. So by using this, you can halve it. You can use only half of the water and it will produce the same yield. Then we've overexpressed the transcription factor SNAC1. So this confers drought and salt tolerance. And then the vacuolar antiporter gene, which actually sequesters sodium inside the vacuole so that the cellular metabolism is protected from the toxicity of sodium. So we have several lines there. And then we have lines in which we produced overexpressed the transcription factor G protein beta, So this confers salt drought as well as heat tolerance. And then we underexpressed, we downregulated the DST gene. So this produces not only salt and drought tolerance, but also high yields. And some of these constructs used constitutive promoters, but some of the constructs had inducible promoters, and some of the lines are actually really very good. So here, this slide actually shows that some of the lines are being tested in the transgenic greenhouse at Biri. But as I said, there is no regulatory approval for any of my transgenic lines as yet. Okay, so changing gears again. Since the last 5 years, we have used the CRISPR-Cas9 technology to downregulate certain genes, but this was mainly for proof of concept for the mechanism of tolerance of Horkuch. So what we did here, this this gel shows, it's a transporter gene called AKT1. So it's mainly responsible for transporting potassium from the soil into the root cell. But what happens is in Horkuch, we saw that this gene was actually downregulated under salt stress. So if you can, if you see this this picture here, so what happens under normal conditions, this particular transporter is going to, because there's enough potassium in the soil, it's going to transport potassium, both for IR29, salt-sensitive IR29 and salt-sensitive Horkuch. But when there's a lot of sodium, when there's sodium stress, then this transporter allows sodium leakage. So what happens in Horkuch under salt stress, this gene is actually downregulated so that there is no sodium leakage. So we wanted to test this concept. So what we did is we wanted to downregulate this transporter in IR29 to see whether IR29 would become tolerant to salt stress. And so we use implanter transformation, And so we designed a guide RNA to target this AKT1 gene. And then we transformed IR29, as, and you can see on the top panel here on the right-hand side, the wild-type IR29, this is sensitive, but the transformed IANA, it remains green after 3-4 days under salt. This is a leaf disc senescence assay. And when we germinate the seeds in salt, so you can see the wild type, this doesn't germinate, but the guide RNA downregulated transgenic lines, these actually are germinating in salt. And when we do the salt screening, you can see the wild type plants, they look like the wild type is this under control conditions, and these are the two other transgenics. And here you can see under salt stress, the wild type IR29 is dead, but these are still surviving. So what we did, what did we prove? We proved that if we downregulate this transporter in salt-sensitive IR29, we get salt tolerance. And then, so this work was done by, again, two master's students, Aisha Laboni and Imran Khan at biochemistry. And then another MSc student, Umme Sabrina Haq, she targeted two more transporters. So here, one transporter is called 2-pore potassium transporter. This is a vacuolar transporter, and another transporter called HAC1. So both of these actually transport potassium. So what we saw in Horkuch, that these two genes were upregulated under salt stress. So we thought that if we downregulated these genes in Horkuch using the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, then did Horkuch become sensitive? And that's exactly what we found, that when we so we designed this guide RNA against this particular transporter, the 2-pore potassium transporter, and we can see that the transformed Horkuch under the leaf senescence assay under salt, it becomes yellow after 4 days. And again, the downregulated HAC transporter gene, that also, when we downregulated it in Horkuch, it becomes sensitive. So what Sabrina Haq did, she designed an animation describing what might be happening here. So here, so we already showed that AKT1 is actually downregulated because it allows sodium leakage. It's downregulated in Horkuch. And then, so with sodium chloride, this is downregulated in Horkuch. But sodium chloride leaks through many transporters. So we can have these non-selective cationic channels, and then HKT, which is going to let sodium chloride in. And so then, sodium increases drastically and potassium goes down because potassium concentration outside the cell is low, and you know, these transporters actually they work both ways, and because the concentration is low outside, potassium just goes out, and then so there's an osmotic and ionic imbalance, and then this imbalance actually causes depolarization at the cell membrane, and this depolarization actually stops the HAC transporters. So I said the HAC transporter is actually upregulated in Horcrux, but not immediately. It's upregulated in 24 hours. So then what happens? But this transporter, which is the TPKA transporter, it's a vacuolar transporter, it's upregulated immediately after salt stress. And what we think is happening is the potassium is going out, the stores in the vacuole are going out of the cell, and this is blocking the further lowering of potassium. And once that happens, the depolarization stops, and then the HAC is upregulated after 24 hours, and this introduces more potassium into the cell, and that's how Horcrux is becoming tolerant. So we are writing the paper now for these mechanisms, and this is blocking it. So this is the work that we did with CRISPR, and these lines are in the T2 generation. And as I said, we showed proof of concept. However, we also produced salt-tolerant IR29 by down-regulating some of the genes which are, you know, being down-regulated in Horcrux. So why is CRISPR-Cas technology, why is it so rapid, and what's the beauty of it? So I want to give a slight overview of the technology. So the beauty of CRISPR-Cas9 is that you can target the gene that you want to edit. In genetic modification, you don't know where your gene is going to end up inside the plant. But in case of CRISPR-Cas technology, you are targeting the gene into targeting a specific gene, and you're editing it or downregulating it. So how do we do it? So we say, you know, we downregulated the AKT1 gene. So say we design, a probe, we call it the guide RNA. So we will have DNA. So see this here, you have your guide RNA, which is against your AKT gene. So it's homologous, it will stop the transcription, it will go and bind to that particular gene in a specific place. And it also needs a scaffold where the guide RNA has associated with it CRISPR-Cas9, which is a nucleus, and it's a double-stranded nucleus. So the scaffold will go and the Cas9 will go and sit in the scaffold. And then, so this, there's a promoter which is going to produce Cas9 in your cell. And then you have, of course, your selectable marker. So what happens is once the guide RNA goes and targets your gene, the Cas9 will go and bind there, and it is going to cut the DNA. It's going to make a double-stranded break, and either the gene will be down-regulated or you can repair it otherwise. I'll show it in the next slide. And the second beauty of guide RNA is that you can target multiple genes at the same time. And of course, the vectors has to be introduced either by agrobacterium or other methods of gene transformation. So once you have produced your transgenic plant, you have to amplify the region that has been edited, and then you have to confirm it by sequencing, and of course you do the phenotyping. So just a little bit of detail. So you have, this is your guide RNA, it's going to go, and because it's homologous to this particular DNA, it's going to go and bind there, so this is the scaffold. The Cas9 is going to go and bind in this scaffold, but it needs a specific sequenced in order to cut at a specific place. So you have to search for it, and there are softwares for you to design where your target will actually target your DNA. Okay, so then Cas9 will produce a double-stranded break, and you can either have the beauty is that the endogenous repair system of the cell will repair it. So it can repair it either by doing some insertion of nucleotides or deletions, whichever it's going to knock out your gene or at least downregulate it. But if you give a donor DNA, then it can actually incorporate that particular DNA inside. But giving the donor DNA, it's rather difficult. There's a new brand new tool in our toolbox for CRISPR-Cas9, and this is called the prime editing. So the prime editing has actually two components. It has the guide sequence with the Cas9, and it has a reverse transcriptase with another template with the edit, with the desired edit, or with the change that you want to make. So what happens here is this prime editing RNA, the Cas9 is actually mutated. It now has, instead of cutting double strand, it's going to cut a single strand only. And this is what happens. So it nicks at it. So this binds as before, and then there's it makes a nick, and then the reverse transcriptase goes and bind. So it uses this primer to synthesize. Synthesize RNA. Okay. Sorry, synthesize from the RNA, synthesize DNA. Okay. So then this can be incorporated. So when the reverse transcriptase synthesizes the DNA according to what edits you have given there, or the template that you've given there, you can have two modes of endogenous repair. Either it doesn't incorporate the edit at all, if it's a three flap cleavage. If it's a five flap cleavage, then actually the whole edit is incorporated and you have your editing. So either you can have the edit remove, or you can have the edit incorporated. So these things are being worked out, and there are commercial companies which are doing this rapidly. So no papers are out yet, you know, using this mechanism to produce a plant yet. But I'm sure we'll have publications by next year soon. So what are some of the, so most of the publications to date are actually down-regulating of genes and how CRISPR-Cas has improved. So before I go into that, the other beauty of CRISPR-Cas9 is that you can actually select for non-GMO. Even if you use agrobacterium, even if you use a selectable marker, you can actually produce non-GMO plants. How do you do that? So say you have, this is your gene-edited plant, okay? So when it's going to self, it's these are the gametes it's going to produce. So the red is the transgenic plant. The green is the wild type, you know, because only 50% of it will be transformed. And then you have the yellow, which are gene-edited plants, because this whole machinery can act in trans. So you will have the gene edits, but without the transgenic baggage, okay? So if you, in the next generation, if you have 16 plants, one out of 16 will be actually have gene-edited, the gene edits, but without the transgenics. So all you have to do is actually select for the gene-edited plant without the transgenic machinery. So you can actually produce non-GMO crops. So hopefully these non-GMO crops will not be subjected to such stringent oversight, and we can release such plants very easily because they will actually be non-GMO. Okay, so so far commercially, what has been done using CRISPR-Cas? High-yielding rice has been produced by down-regulating a gene called GN1A, which is, stands grain 1A. So these are some of the rice that have been produced. These are better, much better than wild type. You can see the plant height as well as the number of flowers, which are much higher. So this publication was 2018, Li et al. And then we have tomato with high lycopene content. Lycopene is an antioxidant, much desired, nutrient. So what they did is they studied the mechanism, and wherever these stars are, they downregulated those genes. And by downregulating, they enhanced the amount of lycopene in tomato. And you can see that these different lines of CRISPR-Cas9 tomato with the different lycopene contents. So this was successful. And then the latest, this is a 2021 publication in which they downregulated several genes and domesticated wild rice. So this is Oryza alta. And as you know, wild rice has a lot of resistant genes, like, you know, abiotic resistance as well as biotic resistance genes. So if you can domesticate wild rice, then you can have the stress tolerance as well as the domesticated will produce the higher yield. So you can have the stress tolerant high yielding rice. So this work is actually very exciting. And this was published in Cell. And Cell, as you know, it's the highest impact factor journal in our type of science. So to summarize what I've been saying so far, so if you do normal crossbreeding using markers, actually, then you can do it in, say, 8 to 10 years. Mutation breeding actually takes the same time. If you do transgenic breeding and if you include the regulatory time, that might take up to 12 years. If you do genome editing, you can do it in only 4 to 6 years because it's very rapid. So as I, you know, in my title, I asked the question, and with CRISPR-Cas9, you can actually produce non-GMO plants. So, and you know, the possibilities are enormous. With now prime editing, you can actually edit and make more useful genes as well. So, and you know, the commercial companies are really gearing up to produce like designer crops, and these will actually be non-GMO. So this is my last slide. I mentioned all the students who have done the work. Thank you very much to them. And then I have my funders. I'll mention my collaborators first. So Tom Younger, University of Texas at Austin, he helped with the SNP genotyping, which was genotyping by sequencing of the Horcoach population and the RNA-seq, the transcriptomics. Harkamal Walia, actually, he hosted one of the students, Sabrina Elias. So her PhD was from Dhaka University, but it was actually a sandwich program, a joint between UT Texas, University of Austin at Texas, and Nebraska University, Dr. Harkamal Walia, as well as ERIE, as well as Dhaka University. So Sabrina did a lot of work. And then we are using the Texas Advanced Computing System for all, you know, all the bioinformatics and everything. So I have to thank them. Abdul Baghi Ismail is at ERIE. He helped with the population and also, you know, with some of the latter work. Dr. Nayanda Tuteja is my collaborator for the transgenic work. Two of the constructs are his from among my lines. And then, of course, I'm working with ERIE and BIRI collaboratively. And then I have funds from Bangladesh Academy of, the government of Bangladesh. And I have funds from Bangladesh Academy of Sciences for some of the transgenic work. And the work at UT Austin, this was actually supported by USAID under the peer program. So it's called an NSF peer project. And of course, the CASP work that was funded by the World Bank, and it's called the NATP project, NATP2 project. So thank you very much for giving me a patient hearing. Thank you very much.